Okay, well, welcome everybody. It's so good to be together to worship God. And as we've been reminded, we're here because we love Jesus. Mm-hmm. And of course, we love him because he first loved us. The Apostle John writes in the first part of his gospel about Jesus, and I get the feeling that, you know, as he sat down to write, he was just thinking back, okay, really how to capture what it meant that Jesus, the Son of God, came to be with us, and how he himself witnessed and lived with and experienced Jesus. And this is part of what he wrote. He said, the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. And he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. Born of God. What an assurance is ours. Perfect submission. Story. This is my song. Your compassion never ends. It is only your mercies that have kept us from complete destruction. So great is your faithfulness. We thank you, Lord. Your loving kindness has begun afresh for us today, as it does every day. And Lord, we claim you as our inheritance. And because of that, we will hope in you and you alone. You are so wonderfully good to those who wait for you, to those who seek for you. And it is good for us to both hope and wait on the salvation of the Lord, because you reward those who earnestly seek you by revealing yourself to us as the God who made us, and the God who loves us, and the God who saves us through the precious blood of Jesus. Jesus, in whose name we pray, and by whose grace alone we dare to enter your presence today. Mm-hmm. Amen. Of Elijah and of Moses, of Ezekiel, and of David. Dry bones coming alive. The year of Jubilee.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of his servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Behold, of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming his flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple to pray. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world.
Always a soul. And you know, that's what I love about the gospel, about Jesus. There's all he does have an answer. He is the answer to the question, so what? Mm-hmm. Yeah? So
Amen.
What?
Yes.
Yes. And so this next song, old gospel hymn, When We Walk with the Lord. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. I love especially the third verse that we're going to sing today. But we can never prove the delights of his love. It's not that his love is not there or withdrawn, but it's for us to prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows and the joy he bestows are for those who will trust and obey. Mm-hmm. All needs to go on the altar. And that's sometimes harder than we think it is. But when we do it, it's the easiest thing in the world.
That's right.
Trust and obey.
For those who will trust and obey. trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy but to trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this beautiful day. We thank You that we're able to come and worship and be with You, and that we can trust You.
Yes, Lord.
Mm-hmm. Lord, we ask You to be with those that were unable to be here for whichever reasons. And bless us all, Lord, as we with life's trials, temptations. Mm-hmm. We ask You to be with those that are in strife, mm-hmm, through wars, etc.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Especially, Lord, to be with those that can't be with their families.
Yes.
And these things we humbly ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I'm not supposed to be too. That song, the last song we sang, is so encouraging, because when you think about when those songs were written, how long ago it was, and they still speak the truth. Like, everything in the world is, oh, that's the olden days, that's the old way, that's the new way is better. But when you start looking at songs that talk about doctrine and scripture, they don't age. We think they do, but they don't. What they're saying, the words that they speak, are truth, as true as when they were written, or true today. And so if we're talking about trusting and obeying, and we are going to trust Jesus for our needs, and we ask the Lord, what should I be giving, or what should I be doing for kingdom work, and we pray about it and we get an answer, then the only thing left to do is obey what He's told us. Mm-hmm. And so I know when it comes to giving, it's hard, because the whole world is telling us that the church is greedy, the church just wants your money, there's no reason to give there. And how wrong they can be, I don't know. That's pretty wrong, because the world would eat your money faster than they'll take it all. And so I just encourage us to continue that act of asking the Lord what you should be giving, what should I give. It's a personal thing. And then when you get an answer, then obey that answer, because if you're not obeying that part of the equation, then the blessings that you're expecting may be deferred. So I had a scripture all picked out and everything, but that song spoke to me this morning. So I would just encourage us to try and make that a part of our routine. Pray about what you should give, and then give what the Lord puts in your heart. Let's pray. Father, thank You for all You do for us, all the provision that You have placed in our lives. And Lord, we sometimes don't appreciate everything that You do for us. But Lord, we just ask that you would give us thankful hearts, generous hearts, and that you would you could take what we do return and increase it to do kingdom work wherever your heart decides it should go. Ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the name of Jesus. So today is a particularly exciting day because Joe is going to be immersed in the family in water this afternoon. And that's going to happen down at Sandra Graffiter's place in the Graffiter Trailer Court. And a few of us can gather to go down there, but probably not all of us. So we don't want to totally invade Sandra's house. But I thought we could have agreement today. And so I'm going to be talking today about following Jesus and what it means to be born again. And so here's the thing, that Joe just kind of came into our midst. And a lot of his success story is from his actually brand new wife. Lord, so it's really great to have them today. And so the thing that is extraordinary about Joe is he is so excited at what's going on. You know, when they were first here, they weren't married. And we started fellowshipping with us. He realized, I need to get married. And he said, how are we going to do that? I said, well, pick up a marriage license. He goes to Camelot's right away. You know, I'm always thinking there's always a bit of time. He phones me from Kamloops. He had just got out of the courthouse, said, I got the license in. When can we get married? Oh, well, I guess we can choose to go. How about tomorrow? Like, as long as you're not in a hurry, you know, tomorrow's fine. I did put it off one day, so we did have a day to prepare. And so we had a little, kind of little wedding here, because they did what they knew God is calling them to do. And so here's Joe. He didn't want any grass growing under his feet. So I'm going to ask him up right now. He's going to just give a little testimony of what I would normally ask at the immersion, baptism. But I'm just going to ask him a few questions, and he's going to give a little bit of testifying. God bless you, Joe. This has been fun getting to know you.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pastor.
So what I like to ask people, okay, are you, first of all, what brought you to faith in Jesus?
What brought me to the faith in Jesus? Well, I actually was always had a spark there. Even when I would go away to work, I would dabble in the Bible almost every evening to take a read something. Mm-hmm. I wasn't sure where it was leading me, and then we heard the singing down here on Sundays.
Oh, back where outside.
From where sitting outside. Hmm? And my wife, God bless her, she says, do you think we could go down and visit that little church? And I said, absolutely. And it drew me down here. The Lord wanted me to come down here. He put Norma Lou in my life to help me, give me that little push. And as soon as I got in through the doors, my heart just opened straight up. And Pastor, you and John and Valerie and everybody else here, I'm just so full. I'm so full. And I am so blessed that God is forgiving my sins. And Lord, I have been a sinner for sure. And I probably will always be. But I will do my best to follow what the Lord wants.
And now you're living under his grace, right?
And I am, absolutely, I'm living under his grace. Mm-hmm. And today is a very special day. Here's where I'm making my commitment to him, and he's making his commitment to me.
Right.
He's forgiven my sins. I appreciate everybody that's here. And I get lost for words. My heart is so full. I believe Jesus Christ died on the cross to forgive my sins, and he rose again, and he remained on this earth for a period of time, and then he went to his Father, and he's taken us with him. And he's going to take me.
That's right.
So, God bless you, our brother in the Lord. So I'm going to give a prayer for you. And one question I'm going to ask you now at the hot tub, too, is do you trust in Jesus Christ alone for your salvation?
I do.
Yes, you do.
I do.
Okay, so we're going to pray for you now, and a few of us will gather. We're going to have coffee and snacks as usual here. There's no rush, but a few of us will maybe gather to go down to the Grafner Credit Corp. But let's pray for you. We're all agreeing together. So, Thank Lord you. Jesus, we just bring our dear brother before you today, Joe, who has been faithful in these last months. He's come to your faith. Thank you for his dear Norma. Bless her for her enthusiasm about his soul. And Father, today we just know that you've raised Joe up in your glory and that he's your child, and that as we witness his baptism today, his being buried with Christ, we're going to talk about that. And Lord, I just pray your protection and guidance and power will fall on him today and for the rest of his life in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
God bless you.
God bless you. God bless everybody here.
So I was thinking, Joe, I never asked your permission, but I was thinking, you know, preachers kind of like to have titles for their sermons. I don't really know why they do, but we tend to. I thought a good title today would be, "What Happened to Joe?" Is that all right?
Yes.
I'm a little tired. I'm going to get down there. It takes a little while to get back up again. So, anyway, here we go. So, we're talking today. Thank you, Joe. NBC. So, we're talking today about what it is to follow Jesus. A Christian is one who is a follower of Jesus. And so if that's what you claim to be, a follower of Jesus, or if you're claiming to be a Christian, that is what you are. You're following him. You're one of his disciples. Jesus called his 12. And all but one of them were faithful to him. And disciple means a follower of, and so we're following Jesus. And there's more than 12 of us here today. So bless his name. And so we're here to acknowledge who Jesus is to us and what it means to be a Christian. Interestingly enough, the word Christian is only used a couple of times in the New Testament. We like the word. It's a good word. But followers of Jesus is a more used word, or disciples is a more used word, or just a believer is a more used word. So sometimes we refer to each other as believers, disciples, Christians, followers of Christ. They're all good words, and they're all true words. So in a way, it doesn't really matter what we call or refer to ourselves as. And so we've looked at John chapter 3 quite a few times. So we're talking today about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Some of you have been a follower of Jesus most of your life, some more recently. And we have all had to come to the same thing, because there's only one way to God the Father. That's through his Son, Jesus Christ. John chapter 3 is a great piece of scripture. And it is talks about the new birth. A new birth? That sounds rather odd to people who are not used to church language or biblical language. The word new birth may seem surprising. We've read this passage many times, but it's important we read it today. Now, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. So remember, generally speaking, Pharisees were enemies of Jesus, because Jesus came, he upset the apple cart. He was upsetting the Jewish religion, and they didn't like him very much. But here's Nicodemus, a leader, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night. Why did he come to him by night? Because he didn't want the rest of his buddies to know. He was secretive. So he comes to Jesus by night, and he said to him, "Rabbi," which means teacher, he says, "we know that you have come from God as a teacher, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." And Jesus answered and said to him, truly, truly. Now, when Jesus says truly, truly, it means listen to this. Listen to this. This is really, really, really important. So he says truly two times. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Don't you think he was snickering when he said that? That's ridiculous. He cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born, can he? And Jesus answered with the same thing again. Truly, truly, listen to this, listen to this. I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Born again, really? That has never been taught in the history of the world until then. No other religion, philosophy, teaching, belief ever talked about being born again. Only Jesus spoke of being born again. I remember talking to someone years ago about faith, and they had said to me, so-and-so was a Christian. He says, I'm a Christian, but I'm not really the born-again kind. And I said to this person, I said, well, it's really the only kind there is. There isn't two kinds of Christians. You're either the born-again kind of Christian or you're not a Christian. So if you want to be a Christian, if you want to be a follower of Christ, it's kind of what you got to be. You got to be born again. And you can't understand it unless you figure it out what's going on spiritually. So that which is flesh is flesh, and that which is spirit is spirit. So you're born the first time. When we're born the first time from our mother, we're born in a watery womb. We're born in the flesh. We're a person, but we have not yet been born into the faith of Jesus Christ. And so that which is spirit, and this is what regenerates us, our faith in Jesus, to be born again, carries on. Farther down the chapter in verse 15, whoever believes will in him have eternal life. And then the famous one that even atheists know this one. They don't believe it, but they've still heard of it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but the world might be saved through him. He who believes in him is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. Just believe. Really? That's all you do is just believe? Well, let me tell you what just believing means. There's a ton of people that say, I believe in God. You know them. Maybe you were one of them. Oh, I've always believed in God. Oh, that's good. Well, you have to believe that God exists. It's not true. When the scripture says he who believes in him means they're believing in everything that Jesus taught. It's not about believing that Jesus existed or that God the Father existed or even that God created you. That's not enough for you to get to heaven. You must believe in the teachings of Jesus. That's why it's good to be called followers of Jesus. If you're going to be a follower of Jesus, you got to do what he says. You got to do what he teaches. And so that song, Trust and Obey, is a wonderful spiritual evangelistic song that God has called. He's called for us to obey him. And we say we believe in him. It means we believe in everything about him, his claim, believe that he is the one that has forgiven us, that will forgive us. And that's where we go to Acts chapter 2. I'm going to kind of move along fairly quickly here. And in Acts chapter 2, referred to as the day of Pentecost, and That was the day that the apostles gathered and they were preaching to the multitudes. Jesus had already gone into heaven. And what's the last things Jesus said? He said, go into all the world, sharing the news of Jesus, sharing the good news, preaching the gospel, he says, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. This day has happened now. Just weeks after Jesus had gone into heaven. And so there's this great sermon. Peter was apparently the lead preacher that day. And so after the sermon, after the words that were spoken of, thousands of people are out on the hills listening to the sermons that the apostles were teaching. And I don't quite know what it would have looked like, but it would have been quite a thing. And so the people spoke out. Okay, we've heard this amazing sermon. We've heard the gospel, the good news of Jesus. Now what do we do? So when they said, now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart. And they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? What shall we do to be saved? What they want to know. And so Peter said to them, repent. And let each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. So then those who had received his word were baptized, and that day there were added about 3,000 souls. That was a busy day. I wonder how many people they had baptizing people. And so what an extraordinary bit of information as tells us how to have a relationship with Jesus. He starts off with believing that he is who he said he is. And then the call is for repentance, which is saying, Lord Jesus, I am sorry for the sin that I have committed. Other places, the scripture says, anyone who says that he has never sinned is a liar and the truth is not in him. You and I have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But what repentance is going the other direction. We're going one direction, you turn around going the other direction, you're going the direction that Jesus has called you and I into. And repentance is, I am so sorrowful. David in the Old Testament was a great man of repentance. Even then he understood repentance. Sometimes at repentance we cry. Do you ever cry over your sin? Do you ever cry or you feel like it? I've sinned, I've done a terrible thing to God. You have, but he's come. He's changed everything. He's changed your destiny. I want to tell you this morning that he changes everyone's destiny that accepted him as their personal Savior, repented of the sin, accepted him. Jesus came into my heart, and that's what happened to Joe. Whatever happened to Joe, he's been redeemed from the hand of the enemy. So have you and I. We've been redeemed from the hand of the enemy. And that is what is so extraordinary about the Christian story. We've been made something that we weren't before. In Romans, quickly, over in chapter 6, we said, 6 and verse 3, or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. You see what baptism or immersion in water represents. We are called to be buried with Christ. So in a sense, when we're baptized, immersed into the faith, we go down into the water. It's a funeral service. The old self, the old Joe, is dying to what it was and is dead to what it was and raises up to walk in newness of life like a brand new baby. That's why it's called being born again. It's the most exciting news that has ever happened in the universe since Adam and Eve was even created. We've been made new. When someone becomes a Christian, they become a brand new person inside. The outside looks the same, but the inside looks different. I do want to also emphasize that the word baptism or baptize means to be dipped in water. That's why sometimes we use the word immersion. It means to be submerged in water. That's what it means. So that's the word that we're using. Baptism does come from the Greek word baptizo, which means to be whelmed with water, immersed in water. In 1 Peter, I won't return to it, but it's interesting how Peter compares Christian baptism to Noah and the flood. He says, as Noah and his family, that is eight people, were saved through the flood by being on the ark. And when Noah stepped out of the ark, eventually with his family, everything was new. All the old had died. Only thing that was alive was that was on the ark. Everything else on the earth was dead. He steps out to a brand new planet. Everything was made new, kind of like being born again. It's kind of like the newness, like God was starting creation over again, almost. And so Peter says, corresponding to that, that's why baptism saves you, because it's the part of the whole. It's what has happened to you. It's what happened to Noah and his family. The old has died, the new has come. In 2 Kings chapter 5, we have the story of Naaman. Many, many, many centuries before this, Naaman was a captain, a ruler, a leader in the Aram, actually, but with an A. And he was a captain in the King Aram's army, and he's well known. And so during one of their invasions, they ended up getting some Israelite people that they brought into their country. And it turns out there's a little servant girl that goes and ends up working in Naaman's household. Naaman was a great man, but one bad thing about Naaman, he had leprosy. And there was no cure for leprosy in those days. And so the servant girl, the Israeli servant girl, tells his wife, oh, I wish Naaman could go back to Israel. I know a prophet that could heal him. She tells her husband. He says, really? He says, goes to the king, can I go and get healed in this other, in Israel? The king sends him off with his blessing. And so he goes off, and first of all, the letter that the king from Aram writes to the king of Israel, actually, which is Ahab at that time, I find out. Didn't really realize that till recently. But so the letter gets to the king of Israel, and he's upset. The king is upset. How can I heal anybody? And the scriptures, I love this. He tore his robes. So when you're really upset, you tear your robes. That's what you're supposed to do. If you're a good Israelite king, you tear your robes, and then that shows that you're really upset. So anyway, the prophet Elisha hears about this. And Elisha sends a message to the king. He says, send him my way. He comes that way. And so Naaman is coming with this huge cohort of guards and supporters in camels and I don't know what else in his glory. And he had gifts. He had gifts for whoever would heal him. And Elisha does a rather strange request. He doesn't even go out and meet him. Seems almost rude. Naaman thought it was rude because all Elisha did was send a message with a messenger out to Naaman. He said, you want to be healed? Go back to the Jordan River and dip yourself seven times in the river. Well, he's a captain of an army. You don't usually... not as you told that sort of stuff. And he said, surely he would have come out and said a great big prayer to his God and waved over the spot that is sick. Surely he would have done that. And he said, I'm going home. I'm heading back to my country. But his servants, Naaman, we've come a long way. why don't you just go try it? Go do what he says. Dip in the river Jordan seven times. Well, we got better rivers at home than we have here in this muddy old Jordan. He was being pretty negative. Anyway, he was convinced. So, okay, I'll go. So he goes to the Jordan River. Now, you got to be, that's a weird request. Dip yourself in the Jordan River. And so he goes into the river, and he dips himself. Six times, nothing. Seven times, he comes up clean. He looks, and the scripture says his skin was as healthy as a young boy. My question is this morning, what healed Naaman? Was it the river? Was it the waters in the Jordan River? Did the river make him clean? What was it who made him clean? It was his obedience. God requires obedience. And it's kind of humbling. Humbling to have to go to a muddy river. I don't know if it was muddy. He thought it was. But he's just being negative. But God has called us to humble ourselves. That's why we bow down to him. And the scripture says, before Jesus comes back, every knee will bow. Realize that? Every atheist you've ever known, every person that has laughed and scoffed at the Christian faith, their knee is going to bow. But it'll be too late. Because Jesus will be on the clouds coming to get us. It says, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. And Jesus said, if you confess me before man, I will confess you before my Father in heaven. But he who will not confess before a man, neither will I confess before my Father in heaven. You notice that Joe confessed God today. He confessed Jesus today. So he doesn't have to wait. He's there. And so we're taking the scripture, the good news, the gospel of Christ, and we're encasing our lives and realize what a wonderful thing that has happened to Joe. And what a wonderful thing that has happened to me. If you have become a follower of Jesus, a wonderful thing has happened to you. Because as Naaman came up out of the water, the leprosy vanished. And the same is true with us. We come to Christ. Our sin has vanished. We go into the water, so to speak. Our sin is left there. Not because of the water, just because of our obedience. We come to faith in Christ. Jesus takes our sin and it vanishes. Yes, we'll sin again, but that sin is covered. We don't go on sinning so that we can just enjoy God's grace. Even the Apostle Paul says that just prior. We don't do that. We don't try to sin. We try to live the life that Christ has called us to live, but we will fail again, won't we? That sin is forgiven already before you've committed it. So God bless us today as we come to the Lord's Supper. We come because, again, it's obedience. Jesus simply said, as often as you get together. The church did that. As often as they got together, they partook in what was referenced to as the Last Supper that Jesus had with his disciples. And so we, as disciples of Christ, are doing what they did 2,000 plus years ago in remembrance of Jesus, the bread and the cup, the body and the blood of Jesus that was given for us. So when we take the bread and the cup, we're spiritually getting involved with the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, because it's that body and that blood that forgave us of our sin. God bless us, Isaac.
Lord Jesus Christ, it's sometimes hard to find words to describe this. We have heard of many people who believe that it takes good works to gain salvation. Those who where once non-believers said that who believe that it takes continuous repentance and good works to heal you of your sin, once asked, how can one man's life forgive all the sin? How can just one death, one man, save all of our lives? Because you were the perfect lamb, God. You described yourself as the perfect lamb, the perfect human being. You were God, you were man. And even after your death, even after all of our sins were forgiven, because sin can only be forgiven by blood. And it was your blood, the blood of Christ, Lord God, that forgave all sins before, now, and to come. And it's so sufficient, it's so overwhelmingly powerful, your blood, Lord God, that it overwhelmed sin. It covered sin like a storm, a massive, massive storm of salvation. It just wiped it out. So Lord, we just gotta thank you so much for this forgiveness, because we are all of us sinners, and we are gonna sin today, we're gonna sin tomorrow, and we're gonna sin next year, and we're gonna sin until we give our last breath. And you know this, and you ask that we continue to repent and come to you, Lord. And so we thank you for this. We thank you for this salvation. And so when we partake of the cup and the bread, we proclaim your death. This communion reminds us that we are to proclaim the death of Jesus Christ. Because when we proclaim your death, we claim that you did in fact die, and that you did in fact rise from the dead. We speak this, Lord, in Jesus' name. May every single person here, when we eat the bread and when we drink the cup, may we all say in our minds, I proclaim the death of Jesus Christ, for he died and his sins have forgiven me of my sins. In Jesus' name, amen.
My life flows on in endless song of lover's lamentation. I hear the
around me.
makes fresh my heart, a fountain ever springing. All things are mine since I am His. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm. While to that rock I'm clinging, since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? Since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for loving us with this an everlasting love. I thank you for the people of faith around the world that are putting their trust in you, Lord Jesus. And thank you for those of us here that are in this room that are have placed their trust and faith in you. We speak blessings upon each one of us, encouragement upon our lives, Lord, that we would testify who you are, what you've done in our life. Grow us, mature us, and lead us into eternal victory. Father, we just want to pronounce today to the heavens that we love you because you loved us first. In Jesus' name, amen.